So last lecture we looked at linear quadratic optimal control, and I also talked about a realistic formulation. Before I move on to the last topic of this series of lectures, that is model predictive control, I want to go over this realistic LQOC formulation again little more systematically than what I did in my last lecture, so that we will understand the foundation why we modified the control law. Okay. Well, it's feedback control. In the last lecture, I found it difficult to explain, so I went back and re-derived. Now, these derivations which are given in particular in my notes are for the innovation bias approach, are not appearing in any book. So, but I had to re-derive some of those ideas. They are there in different forms, but the specific formulation that is given here is not there. So, we had two problems. One problem was we had to deal with disturbances. We had to deal with disturbances. Right now, at this stage, let me not qualify whether they are measured or unmeasured. We have to deal with disturbances. Okay? We looked at a system when we started doing linear quadratic optimal control. Let me just remind you. We just looked at this model, right? We just looked at a model in which there were no disturbances, there were no measurement error. Only problem that we wanted to look at was to bring the system from non-zero initial state to final state equal to 0, 0 origin. That was the only problem that we wanted to study. And then why we have done this, I mean, once you have done the whole derivation and come to the realistic formulation, you realize that you have done this because you wanted to come up with a formula for coming up with G infinity, controller gain. Okay. Once you get the controller gain, then you know you can modify to do other things. For example, disturbance rejection, set point tracking, all those things you can do further modifications. So now we derived the controller for this simplistic looking model. Okay. Now what I want to show that even when you have disturbances, okay, even when you have disturbances, or if you want to take it to some arbitrary set point, okay, you can transform the model to a model which looks very, very similar to this. If I have done that, then I have achieved what I wanted to do, that is rejecting disturbances and moving to any arbitrary set point. That is, okay. So I will move directly to, and then, well, let me just throw this one slide again, and then we wanted to design an LQ controller which moves to the origin. The way we did this was we took a finite horizon formulation here and then we let n go to infinity. We did the derivation by taking a finite horizon formulation, let n go to infinity, and then we found the solution. Okay. Now let's go to a more realistic formulation. Okay. So let me start here. Problem of designing a linear quadratic optimal control, okay, for a system which is governed by this difference equation now. Okay. I am adding two terms here. One term is a constant disturbance in the state and a corresponding coupling matrix. Okay. Why I have used some different notation here will eventually become clear. Okay. I could have used gamma d. We have been using gamma d here. In some cases you know the disturbance, then you can use gamma beta equal to gamma d. In some cases you do not know the disturbance, then what do you do? So all those questions we will answer subsequently. So right now I am leaving it fuzzy. I am not saying that this is a measured disturbance or unmeasured disturbance or whatever. I am leaving it open. Okay. Similarly, I am assuming that there is some additive disturbance in the output. There are two disturbances in the system. One is the input disturbance and then there is an output disturbance. Right now I am assuming them to be constant, not time varying, step change like disturbances. Okay. I want to control the system I want to control this system at an arbitrary set point R. Okay? Right now, let's assume the constant set point. Okay? Let's assume a constant set point. Is this clear? Now, I am taking a more realistic formulation. There is a disturbance in the state, which is constant. There is a disturbance in the measurement, which is constant. And I want to take the system to set point R as k goes to infinity. I want to reach a set point R. R is an arbitrary set point. We are looking at deviation variables. Like I said, if you take the quadruple tank setup, then 0, 0 corresponds to the initial steady state where you are linearized. And you might want to take it to some other set point, which is not 0, 0. So level equal to, you know, minus 4 centimeters and plus 3 centimeters or whatever. So that could be. So I should be able to specify any set point. I should be able to reject disturbances. That is my ultimate goal of any controller design. And then I seem to have done a design for a very simplistic system where there were no disturbances, and I said I want to control at the origin. Now, how do I tie these two together to achieve what really I want to do? Okay. So let us assume that somehow at this stage, okay, we know this signal beta s, we know this gamma beta. We also know this signal neta s, and we know this gamma neta. I should have put c neta here. Slight error in my. There's a typo here. This should be c neta. So because this is c, I have called this c subsequently, and because this is gamma, I have called this gamma. This is a slight typo. I'll correct that. Okay. And here too, you just correct this with c neta. Okay. So now, what happens is, what is the steady state of this particular equation? This is the steady state equation. Okay, at a steady state, xs is equal to phi xs into gamma us plus gamma beta into beta s. This is the steady state input disturbance. Okay, this is the steady state output disturbance. This is my steady state equation. Okay, now I can from the steady state first equation. Okay, from this first equation, it follows that, you know, I just take this phi s on the left hand side, I will get I minus phi s inverse into, is this clear? From the first equation, it just follows this particular. And then I can substitute for R, okay, all these terms. If I just substitute for xs here, okay, I eliminate and get the relationship between R, US, beta s and neta s. Okay. Now, I have assumed that beta s is known to me, neta s is known to me, this matrix is known to me, this matrix is known to me, all the matrices here are known to me. Okay. R is given to me, set point is given to me. I want to reach the set point R. So, operator has given me a set point. Okay. Who specifies the set point? Operator, as you as a control engineer, we specify the set point. I want to reach this particular point. Okay. So you are given the set point. So what is not known here is input US. Okay. That should be maintained to achieve this set point in the face of these disturbances. Okay. That can be computed now. So I am just, what I am doing here is this particular complex matrix C into I minus phi gamma I minus phi inverse into gamma, I am going to call it as KU. This is just a notation, simplified notation. Same thing is for this particular matrix, I am going to call this as K beta. Okay. And then this C theta remains here. Okay. So when number of inputs equal to number of outputs, that means number of controlled outputs is equal to number of manipulated variables. This KU matrix, okay, this gain matrix, KU gain, this is steady state gain matrix, if you realize, nothing but a steady state gain matrix. This steady state gain matrix will be square, and if the system is controllable, this particular system will be, this gain matrix will be invertible. You should be able to go take the system to whatever final steady state that you want. Okay, so this KU will be invertible matrix, in which case you can write US to be this. Substitute back, you will get XS. Okay. So if you happen to somehow know the disturbances and if you happen to know the set point, then you can find out an steady state that must be reached to achieve those set points and to reject the disturbances. Okay? In spite of the disturbances, if I maintain this US, I should reach this excess. Maintaining this excess implies I have reached R. That's where I wanted to be, right? I wanted to be at Y is equal to R as K tends to infinity. Okay? So, if I maintain this US, then I will reach excess. If I reach excess, I will reach R. That's what I wanted. I wanted to reach the set point R. If I just do this, I will reach the set point R. Everyone with me on this? Okay? And of course, if KU is not invertible, if the number of inputs are more than the number of outputs, then you can always replace this by a pseudo inverse. That's not a problem. Okay. Now, what I am going to do is, I am going to subtract this model. I am going to subtract this model from the original model that I considered, that is this model here. Well, of course, replace this by C here. So, this dynamic model and this steady state model, I am going to subtract. Okay? I am going to subtract these two models. Once I subtract these two models, I get this model. The constant disturbance terms disappear. Okay? Constant. Is it clear? The tricks that I am doing? Now, I subtracted the dynamic model and the steady state model from the dynamic model. Okay? So, what I got is this, let's call this delta model. Okay? Let's call it delta model. So, this delta model is xk plus 1 minus xs. Now, this model looks like the model for which we have developed LQ controller. Okay? This model looks like, so I can define this delta xk, I can define delta uk, I can define delta yk. This is just translation of the model. If you realize, you are just translating the model. Okay? You are changing the origin, that's all. Okay? Now, what is the meaning of controlling this model at the origin? If you control this model at the origin, then that means xk is equal to xs. If xk is equal to xs and uk is equal to us, okay, that means you have achieved the set point at the desired set point in spite of the disturbances in the output and in the state. Okay? So, my controller design is done for this particular model, and then you got this controller. Okay? In terms of delta, you got the controller, which was the controller which is LQ controller. Okay? You have chosen WX matrix and WU matrix, all that you have done, and then you got this controller. And then, so origin of this particular system corresponds to the desired set point. Okay? So, actually when I implement this control law, I implement it like this. Okay? When I implement the control law, I implement it like this. Okay? Is this clear? So, basically what I am going to do next is I am going to change my controller like this. Now, there is a transition from the previous slide to this slide. See here. Here I said this is XS and US, they were not time varying. Okay, they were not time varying because I had made two simplistic assumptions. One simplistic assumption was disturbance levels are constant, but disturbances can be drifting. Okay, disturbances can be drifting. Second, I had made an assumption that set point given is constant, but you may have a set point trajectory. See, for example, if you are controlling an aircraft and you want to take off, okay, then you want to go from height 0 to height whatever, you know, 2 kilometers, and you are given some set point trajectory. The way you should go is like this. Okay, so pilot will give a set point trajectory to the autopilot, and the autopilot will cruise the aircraft from the given level to the higher level. Okay. When the situation comes when the set point is constant, when the aircraft is cruising at a constant height, okay, the set point is constant. Then you only have to worry about the disturbances like wind gusts. Many of you have traveled in aircraft, so you would know. Suddenly you will get some wind gust and then aircraft will start shaking. And then you need a controller which will, and this is typically done by the autopilot, automatic controller, onboard autopilot will be onboard computer doing LQ controller, predictive controller, whatever. The pilot doesn't now do this sitting there. He would leave it to the controller to do that stabilization at. So the disturbances could be time varying, the set point could be time varying. So I am trying to now modify this control law to accommodate both the possibilities. So I am saying that this XS and US, so the translation that I do also need to be time varying. If the disturbances are time varying and if the set point is time varying, then the translation of the linear system model that I need to do is also time varying. That is the logic which is used here to deal with any kind of disturbances, deal with set point tracking. Okay. So I am now talking about RK. RK is the set point trajectory. It is changing at each time instant. Okay. So here XS and US are the steady states that are estimated based on the current set point at time k and the current level of disturbances. Disturbances can change in future, I will adapt to that. Okay. So this is the basic idea. So what is done in this innovation bias approach is that I have this observer which is developed from this observer which I have here, I have taken prediction form. The reason for taking prediction form, of course I said the simplicity in derivations, but also a prediction form of this kind can be arrived through time series modeling. You have developed Box-Jenkins models or you have developed Ermac models, developed equivalent state space realization, you will get this directly. You will get K infinity directly. Okay? Or you will get, L infinity directly. That's what you get. You go back and look at your notes, you will see that I have made these connections. That actually time series model is nothing but this Kalman filter, steady state Kalman filter. Okay. So I have this observer. This observer could be derived from first principles, then Riccati equations and this. It could be derived directly from data, Box-Jenkins model or Ermac model, state realization, you get this form. Okay, doesn't matter. Now, what I said is that I do not have a disturbance model right now. Let's assume that there are all unmeasured disturbances. They are all unmeasured disturbances. Okay. And if they were really unmeasured disturbances were really white noise, then this we know that EK will be a white noise. Okay. But then I showed you that if EK is not going to be a white noise when the disturbances in the input side are step like or drifting disturbances, they are not going to be, the EK is not going to be a white noise in that case. Okay. So or if there is a model plant mismatch, EK is not going to be a white noise. Okay. So what we do in such case is following. I talked about this filtering of the disturbances. So what I am going to do now, let me go back here. What I am going to do now, I am going to take this EK to be same as beta which I used earlier. You remember I used that beta and gamma beta. Okay, I am going to take this L infinity and EK to be representative of disturbance in the state, okay, and L infinity to be the corresponding coupling matrix. Okay, see here what I needed when I went here, I needed this term gamma beta beta. Okay. What I am going to do here is I am going to pretend that this L infinity is nothing but gamma beta and EK is representative of the unmeasured disturbance which are drifting. Okay. So of course this unmeasured disturbance has two components, one a slow component, other one is a fast component. I want to knock off the fast component. I want to look at the low drift, low frequency drift, which I am going to do using this filtering business. I'm going to filter this innovation errors, and then filtered value I'm going to take as a representative of the unknown disturbances. And then what? Then I'm going to just do this mapping. Okay. I'll say that my beta S is nothing but ESK. Okay. Beta gamma is nothing but L infinity. Okay. Then I'll say that neta S is nothing but EFK. And C neta is nothing but identity matrix. Okay. Moment I do this mapping, then I can use all that I have done earlier. But I have to make one more assumption here. Okay. What is that assumption? I have to make the assumption that the disturbances do not change in future. You have to think about this. This is a little deeper thing here. That I am making an assumption that disturbance at whatever is the current filtered value of the innovation, that is not going to change in the future, that remains constant. It's like a step. That's what I'm going to assume right now. Okay? This is a simplifying assumption to add, or this another way of looking at it is that it is adding an integrator into the system, but that you'll probably realize later. That I'm actually making an assumption that this beta is actually is remaining constant over the horizon or from 0 to infinity. Okay, I am adding a simplifying assumption here. Same thing is true about the output disturbance. I am saying that there is a constant output disturbance, there is a constant input disturbance, and both of them can be approximated using this filtered value. Okay, moment I make this simplifying assumption, okay, then my control law can be, you know, you just substitute here for gamma beta and C neta, and then beta and neta, you substitute those values, you will get the control law. Okay. This particular control law can deal with drifting disturbances. It can deal with changing set points. Is that okay? So that the trick to arrive at this was to shift the origin. Okay. In fact, shift the origin continuously on the fly. Okay. You will define what is the origin. Okay, and then try to use the law that was derived to control at the origin to deal with the system which is actually changing, which has changing disturbances, or to track the set point. Okay, so this is a trick. All these things are possible, of course, because we are dealing with linear systems. You can do all kinds of manipulations. Okay, linear algebra allows us to do all kinds of nice things, and that's why we are able to design the controller only for a very simplified model, then complicate the model and use the same controller. All these things are possible because of linearity. Okay? The real world, of course, is not linear, it's non-linear. But when approximations of linearity hold, we can use this manipulation and implement these controllers. Okay? Yeah. Huh. Which will? Yeah. So actually, this I have taken another shortcut here because I have assumed that while I'm just trying to give you analogy and then do this. There's one more deeper thing here because you are using observer and plant together, and then that the real derivation will be more complex. But I'm just trying to show it by analogy that you know it's as if assuming that there is a model which has beta k equal to L infinity, and if you were to assume this, you will arrive at the same controller. That's what I want to say. Okay. So it's a to do what that to show truly it gives you offset free behavior, I should consider the plant, which is a different state space model, observer, which is x hat, and then show that how offset is removed and all that. But instead of doing that, I am taking a kind of shortcut by showing parallel. Okay, and so hope that you will understand it, and then you know actual derivation if you want to do for both together will be a little more complex, there will be a lot more algebra, but it can be derived and that's not a problem. you can have in the carbon footprint. I am just using Pareto form as one, easier to do lot of derivations. I don't have to write two equations every time for a observer. So I can just do with only one single equation. That's why I am writing. Okay, so let's now move to predictive control, which is the thing that I have been waiting to teach right since the day one. Okay, so as I said in my last lecture, model predictive control is, it's a multivariable controller, online multivariable controller that uses a dynamic model explicitly. Okay, it's one of the most widely used controllers in the industry today. Started with the chemical industry, now it has spread to everywhere. It is used in all kinds of applications. Well, these two are the first to implement it industrially. One was done in Shell. In 1976 or 74, they first implemented on the real problems. But there was a paper in Automatica by this group from France, and I think it was a closely held technology because it could do online control of a complex plant. It was a computer control, and probably one of the first large-scale computer control system applications. Why it was done in the chemical industry first? That is because the chemical processes are very slow. Okay, and you have time to compute. Okay, so my furnace, if I am controlling, or a distillation column I am controlling, the time constant of a distillation column could be 45 minutes, 1 hour, and the settling time can be 5 hours, 4 hours, 10 hours. So the sampling time for control can be as large as 10 minutes, 5 minutes, 10 minutes. And then in the computers of those times, you could only solve problems where you have time to compute. So all the computations could be probably done in 30 seconds, online computations. So 30 seconds is pretty large compared to if I want to control a robot using these methods, okay, then I need very fast computations, and that is now possible. So that's why the technology which started with chemical industry has now moved to systems which are very fast, okay, aircraft control and all kinds of things. But it started all with chemical industry because chemical processes are very slow, lot of time to compute. Why do you need time to compute online? There is a departure here from the philosophy of control that we have been used to. We had one fixed controller, PID controller, for example. It has three parameters, PID. Okay, one differential equation or one difference equation being solved online, okay, which is very, very simple. You don't require any big computing time for this. You could do it very, very quickly. Okay, LQ controller, once you define a G infinity matrix, once you find it G infinity matrix, what all things that you need for online implementation? Matrix multiplication, you need to write an observer. And then you need matrix multiplication subroutines, multiply matrix by vector, matrix by matrix, whatever. If you have those things, you have some few calculations to be done at each control time, okay. You have to compute the predicted state estimate, x hat k given k minus 1, that involves L infinities. You compute L infinity, G infinity, you have to gain matrices. You just need, three equations. One is the observer equation. First you find out the innovation, then find the observer calculations, and then implement the control law. Okay, so it is that easy. It is just two, three equations to be solved online. It's very easy. Here we are going to depart from that. Okay, we are going to have a controller in which calculations will be done at each time instant separately. Okay, and then it has been used in very large dimensional problems. I'll come to that little later. So what is this controller about? This controller is same as optimal controller, except some modifications. Okay, it is not going to be different from the quadratic optimal control. It is just a cousin of quadratic optimal control, but it is more practical, suited for real problems than quadratic optimal control. Well, what is the difference between quadratic optimal control and this? The first point is not a difference. Multivariable interactions, multiple input, multiple output systems, linear quadratic optimal control can deal with it, not a problem. We are using a multiple input, multiple output model, the controller which you design using LQ approach will be handling multiple input, multiple output interactions. Okay, so that is not an issue. Second thing is a problem. What about constraints? What are constraints? Let's take a simple example of devising a controller, okay, to navigate a vehicle within IoT. Okay, what are the constraints? Just translate a real problem into control constraints. What are the constraints? Speed limit. Good. Second, it has to be on the left side of the road, left half of the road. You know, the trajectory cannot be arbitrary. Okay, there's only certain path which it has to follow. It, you may have an ideal path which is set point, but it may not follow the set point, you know. So it has a boundary within which it has to be there. What else? Manipulation. What about manipulation? Can you have infinite manipulation? Can you increase can you increase the speed at any rate at which you want? No. You cannot. There'll be some limit on the fuel injection. Okay, there'll be a maximum limit on the fuel injection, there'll be zero limit. You cannot go below zero. You cannot have negative fuel injection. So that is not possible. You cannot have fuel injection higher than certain value. There'll be a maximum fuel injection at rate of fuel injection. Okay, so then rate at which you can ramp the fuel injection, will it be limited? It will be limited. You know, you drive motorcycles or cars, you know that you, it's not that just because you press the accelerator at whatever speed you want, the real injection is going to be at that. You know, it's going to be whatever maximum rate it can deliver, that is the only rate it can deliver. Okay, so there are real constraints on the system. There are other kinds of constraints. See, for example, when I am driving the car, there is a constraint that I should run the motor or I should run the engine in such a way that carbon monoxide emissions should be as small as possible or should be zero. Okay, efficiently running the engine. So fuel to air ratio has to be very carefully maintained. Otherwise, you know, you will have unburnt hydrocarbons leaving into the atmosphere. So there are atmospheric or environmental regulations which will tell you how you should run the engine. Same thing is true about some other system, take chemical plants. Chemical plants, you know, what you release into the atmosphere, there is a regulation. You cannot release any amount of, you know, atmosphere or to the water. Okay, so there is a regulation on coming from environmental considerations. There are real problems. You are running a furnace. Okay, there is a maximum rate at which you can inject the fuel. You cannot inject the fuel at infinite rates. But when you write a LQ controller, it just says that controller output is gain times, you know, the state. There is no way of saying in that LQ controller that actually UK is bounded. UK is not any other, any value it can take. So what do you do if you want to implement a LQ controller with bounds? Then what you do is, you in the software, you put an artificial limits. You say that if controller calculates input which is higher than this value, then do not send that value to the actuator, you know, send a value which is equal to what is its limit. So there are ad hoc things that you have to do to maintain the system within the bounds. This is possible when there are input bounds. What about output bounds? What about the fact that I am driving my LQ controller, I make a move and my vehicle goes outside the boundary after some time, not now. After 15 minutes, if I make a wrong move now, my vehicle is going to go outside the road. Okay, so what about this? My LQ controller cannot really predict this, that after some time there will be a violation of constraint on the output, not just the input, and this is going to happen after some time, not now. Okay, so all these other examples, I want to ramp up the temperature in the furnace. Okay, and there is a, you know that there are overshoots many times, temperature will overshoot. Okay, you want to go from 800 to 850. Okay, you start injecting more fuel, the temperature overshoots to 900. Okay, you don't want to go to 900. It might be touching the limit of, you know, some safety limit. You don't want it to go to, you know, beyond say 870. But when you start doing this, you have no clue when it is going to go to 870. It will happen in future. Okay. The basic idea in model predictive control is that if you have a model online, you use to do it forecasting. Okay. You can use and foresee what's going to happen in future and then manipulate your control action now such that the future violations of the constraints are eliminated. Okay. I'm going to do this online all the time. Every sampling instant, I'm going to use this model, do predictions over the future. Okay. Now, how much in future? How do you drive a car? When I'm driving a car, okay, starting from my hostel or starting from my home to, let's say, my office, I don't have a plan for the entire trajectory. I have a plan for next 10 meters. Okay. I implement that and then I have another plan for next 10 meters. Okay. Now, I implement that and then I have another plan for next 10 meters. Maybe there is somebody crossing in between suddenly, I see, and I have to change my plan. So, I cannot have one plan, I cannot have one optimal plan for the entire trajectory. I need to have a plan which is changing as a function of time. Looking at the disturbances, looking at the trajectory, you know, maybe in between there is some work going on and the road is bad. I need to change my policy for, you know, accelerating or braking. Okay. I need to do that depending upon the situation, current situation. So, what is the basic idea here? The basic idea is very, very simple. Actually, model predictive control is much more easy to understand than LQ and all those things. Because this is something that we keep doing all the time. Okay. When we keep working, we have a dynamic model for the plant. Whether you do it knowingly or unknowingly is a different story. Maybe after listening to this lecture, you will realize that this is what you have been doing all the time in different contexts. Whether it is driving a car, or whether we are dealing with a course, or whether you are dealing with your friends, this is what we keep doing. So, given a dynamic model for the plant, what we do is we actually try to foresee what are the possible consequences of actions that I take now. Okay, actions that I take now, and then based on the forecast, I decide what is the next move that I should make. Okay. So, what is happening here in model predictive control? In model predictive control, there is always a dynamic model which is running in parallel to the plant. This model is used for forecasting. Okay. And actually, you solve or you formulate an online optimization problem. At each sampling instant, you formulate an optimization problem. Okay. Over a finite window, let me just picturize this and then tell you. So, what I am going to do is, I am standing here at instant k. Okay. K plus 1, k plus 2 is all future. Okay. K minus 1, k minus 2, k minus 3 is all past. I am standing right now at instant k. Okay. Now, this is inside my computer. Well, I am sitting inside the computer. I have this difference equation model. Okay. I can play with this difference equation model. I can do forecasting. What if I give this input sequence? What will happen after some time? Okay. So, I can, for every forecasted input in the future, see, I am putting here a terminology, uk plus l given k. What does it mean? It means that input that I am contemplating, I have not implemented it. Okay. I am going to implement this contemplated input only on my model inside the computer. Okay. If I use this contemplated input on the model, okay, model will tell me what will happen in the future. Okay. Model will tell me what is going to happen in the future. And then that forecast is used to make the decisions now. Okay. So, if I can forecast, I can see that, you know, for a certain input, actually the predicted behavior will cross the target. Suppose this is my constraint. Suppose this is the temperature limit. Okay. then I want to move from this point, current point, to this set point in such a way that I never cross this boundary. Okay? If I have a fixed gain control law, it is difficult to see what is going to happen in future. Here I can explicitly see what is going to happen in future, because I am going to do simulations in future. Okay? See, when you are driving a car, you have a constraint that you should not hit an object. Right? So just imagine what you do when you drive the car and apply brake, and you actually have a dynamic model for the car behavior in your mind. You dynamically construct a model for the object which is moving. Somebody comes on the way. See, there are times when somebody is crossing the road, okay, you don't brake. There are times when somebody is crossing the road, you brake. Why? Because you have a model for the car, you know when you will reach certain point. Okay, and then you develop a model mentally. Well, we are far superior computers than all these. So we can predict when somebody is going to cross the road and whether our car will be there at that point before or after, and accordingly we can plan our actions. And this is a decision only for that particular window of time. You don't, you know, once the object is gone, you change your policy again. You start accelerating again. Okay, so you have a plan which is dynamic. Okay, so the idea is that standing at this point, I only forecast over a finite window in future. Okay, I do forecast over, let's say, next 20 minutes or next 15 minutes. Okay, using this forecast, I am going to find out somehow this future optimal set of future inputs, such that I reach the desired set point without violating the bounds, without violating the bounds on the inputs. Okay, I am going to do this without violating the bounds on the inputs. I am going to do it without violating the bounds on the states. Okay, what I am going to do then is I am going to implement only one move. I am going to implement only one move into the plant, inject one move into the plant. Okay, I move to this new point k plus 1. Okay, I reformulate my problem of deciding controller moves from k plus 1 to k plus p plus 1. So I have a moving window in time. Okay, I formulate my control problem over a moving window in time, and each time I solve it, I just make, I don't trust my, see, if you make this decision that, you know, you have some object coming and then you are going to slow down for next, let's say you take a decision every 10 seconds and you keep it for 10 seconds. Okay, you have a policy for, you know, 10 seconds, for next 2 minutes you are going to slow down. Okay, and then you will accelerate after some time. This is your optimal policy right now looking at the object. Okay, but then after 10 seconds or 20 seconds, what happens is that the fellow who is crossing sees that a car is coming. Okay, he decides to run and cross the road. Okay, then you suddenly have, you revise the policy. You don't say that, well, I decided to go slow for next 2 minutes, I am going to go slow. You don't do that, right? You, after 10 seconds or after 20 seconds, you revise your policy. You say that, okay, now the things have changed. Okay, let me now accelerate again. So let me change my policy. So you don't trust your moves, future moves, for a long time. You just trust them for a short period and then you change them. Right? You look at the way we deal with, you know, let's say exams. Okay, so you know, k plus 1, k is today, k plus 1 is tomorrow, k plus 2 is day after tomorrow. And what are the disturbances? Quizzes and, you know, yeah, and real life problem. And then, you know, depending upon what happens in the particular quiz today, you decide your plan of what is the input, the preparation that you do for an exam to achieve certain goal. What is the set point? Of course, 10 out of 10. So, and then what you do is you change your policy of preparing for a particular course depending upon, there are multiple inputs. One is what is being taught in the class. Okay. Second is what is quizzes and your performance. So there are so many inputs that keep coming to the system, and then you don't say that I have decided to work only 1 hour per day for next 15 days. You don't do that, right? You probably implement your plan only for today. Tomorrow something else happens, your particular quiz paper gets graded, and then you decide, no, I'm going to change my plan. I'm going to do it for 2 hours a day or 3 hours a day, whatever. Okay. So we have a moving plan, and at any time within a semester, we'll have a plan for the next 7 days, let's say. Okay. And then that keeps changing depending upon the situation, depending upon what is happening in the classes, what is happening in the exams, what is the result. And so you keep adapting, and you don't have a plan over a longer horizon. You have a plan over a shorter horizon. So this is called prediction horizon in predictive control. Okay. You have a prediction horizon, you keep predicting your moves or predicting behavior over the next 7 days, and then you keep adapting. You only implement one move at a time. You don't trust your optimal moves for a long time. Okay. So my idea is going to be this. My optimization problem is formulated over a finite window of time, and this window is going to move, okay, as I move in time. Okay. So another analogy for this would be, you know, you're walking in the dark, okay, and when you have a torch with you, with the torch you can see only 50 meters. Okay. You take one more step, you see next 50 meters. Okay. So you are just every time going ahead into future, and you move one step ahead and you see 50 meters next. Yeah. K plus P here, what I am saying here. K plus P. P. So at each optimization, at each point, I am going to form an optimization problem and solve it online. Okay, I am going to solve this problem online. Optimal solution of this particular problem is not going to be a closed form control law. It is solution of an iterative optimization scheme. Okay, so what becomes very, very important here is to have very efficient online optimization procedures. Fortunately, they are available. You can solve very large optimization problems in thousands of variables in fractions of a second now. With the available computers, with so much advances in the optimization, you can do that, and that's why all these things are feasible now. And then you move on in time as a moving window. Okay. So what is important here is that you are doing proactive constraint management. Every time you make sure that the inputs are within the constraints, the projected outputs, the forecasted outputs are within the constraints. Okay. So that you keep ensuring every time, and this is where it actually replaces a programmable logic controller where, you know, you handle constraints through ad hoc means. Here the model, the control problem knows that there are constraints and it tries to handle it in a very systematic manner. Okay. So what are the basic components of a model predictive control? Of course, one is the state estimator, okay, or the internal model. Well, I am going to present everything in state space format. I am going to present everything using observer and all that. That is not how historically it developed. Okay. Historically, it developed through different ways. People first started using what are called as finite impulse response models and finite step response models. And then later on, the connections with the state space models were shown. And then now, there are packages available in the industry which are based on the state space models. So all this merging of all different ideas which I have done in the course has not happened exactly at the time the whole thing got developed. It was developed in a different way, and then, you know, people merge different ideas and you have a model form now. So earlier people, when those who actually developed these controllers in the shell did not try to use Ermac. Well, it's not that they didn't know about Ermac, but they didn't try to use Ermac. There are certain difficulties when you go to noise modeling. So they use some simplistic noise models, and they did not use observers the way we are using now. So this was in early 70s. Not that those theory wasn't there, but that the confidence to use it wasn't there for large scale plants. And then state estimator. The next thing is that how do you handle predictions? How do you predict over the future? Okay. And the third thing is online optimization. How do you solve the problem online in a fraction of a second using an optimization scheme? Okay. So the three components. So observer modeling, this I have covered painfully through many lectures. Okay. And in my opinion, in any model predictive control scheme, the key thing is the model. Okay. You start from a scratch and develop a model which gives you good predictions. Okay. And you can appreciate when you are driving a car, the key thing is the mental model you have for the dynamics. Dynamics of the car and the dynamics of the object which is moving in front of you. It could be another car, it could be a person who is crossing, whatever. Okay. That model that we are able to develop is so critical in driving the car that if that model is not good, there is accident. Okay. So the modeling is the key to predictive control. Then you know you are going to use quadratic programming, which is an efficient way of solving a problem, or linear programming, LP. So all those codes can be used. Those can solve a large scale problem. So we are going to pose this control problem finally as a linear quadratic optimal control or LQ, quadratic programming problem, or linear programming problem, LP. Okay. And so so I just want to emphasize, now the controller will consist of a state estimator which is running in parallel and an optimizer, online optimizer. Online optimizer will solve the control problem at every sampling instant, presumably in a fraction of a second. Okay, that is what is assumed. The time required for solving the control problem, even though it is optimization problem, is significantly small compared to the sampling instant, sampling interval. Sampling interval, if it is 1 minute, I should be able to solve this control problem in 1 second. If sampling interval is 1 second, I should be able to solve this problem in 0.001 second. It's possible now. 1 millisecond is not a big deal. You can have microprocessors which can solve an optimization problem iteratively online, fraction of a second. Not difficult. Entire window. We'll only use one, and then we will move to the next optimization problem. So we will be solving optimization problem one after another. There is no one optimization problem. See, what was the problem with LQ formulation? We made one giant problem. We said from time 0 to time n, and n goes to infinity. So which means in LQ formulation, we tried to solve the problem as one mega problem from time 0 to time infinity. It's like saying, you know, design one controller that will move you from, that will move your car from your hostel to here, okay, in solving one optimization problem offline. There we did not solve it online. We used lots of tricks. We came up with these Riccati equations, and then we came up with a solution which was optimal solution, unconstrained optimal solution. It was nice there, but now, you know, I'm going to say that, well, I cannot have one controller which is, you know, which is like panacea to moving system from initial point to some final point. That's not possible. Okay. So now let's start doing the predictions. We are at the point K. Is everyone with me with this equation? We have this equation. Well, I intend to change this to L infinity to be consistent with the notation. I made some small errors. Those I'll correct. I'll upload a corrected version. And sorry if you have to take printout of some of the things again. But notations have to be very, very consistent. I make one mistake in notations. But LP is nothing but L infinity, the same as L infinity. Okay. The observer gain. Now, this kind of a model could be obtained as a Kalman predictor, it could be a Leuenberger observer. I am not qualifying this observer to be of any particular type. It can be whatever is your choice. You can do it as a Leuenberger observer. It can be a realization of a Rmax model. It can be a Kalman predictor, whatever. I don't care. I have this model, I have this state observer. Okay. I'm going to use this state observer to do predictions. Okay. Now, so current at time k, my estimate of x is given by this equation. It should be Yeah, Ek is this, so Ek minus 1 will be Yk minus 1 and correspondingly, this will be, when you are using Ek minus 1 here, it will be Yk minus 1 and x at k minus 1, k minus 2, okay. Okay, now we are at the time point xk. We have the state, estimate of the state at the current time point, okay. I want to move into future, okay. So what I am going to do now, I am going to call this, there are again two ways of doing it. One way is this innovation bias approach, the other way is state augmentation. I am not going to describe the state augmentation, I am going to describe innovation bias approach, okay. So the same things which I did earlier, I am going to filter this innovations and take a filtered signal. So this is what we have done earlier for the LQ controller. And now, okay. Now look at this problem of simulations into the future or forecasting into the future, okay. If you give me a guess of future inputs, I am going to call them as uk plus j given k. This notation means this is a contemplated future input, not actually implemented on the real system. It will be implemented only on the model, okay. It will be implemented on the model inside my computer, okay. It's only for internal forecasting. Okay, so this is my, let's say you give me one set of such inputs. What should be important? That is, these inputs are within the bounds. Okay. Then how can I use the model to do forecasting? If I know the input, okay, if you give me a future input, can I use my model to do forecasting? Okay, what I am going to do is this forecasted trajectory, I have given here a different notation, z, just to differentiate the fact that this is forecasted. This is not really going to happen, may or may not happen, I am just forecasting, okay. So I am using my old difference equation, you just go back here, I am just using this, I am going to use this difference equation, okay, in slightly different way. I am going to use this equation, the same equation. So what is known to me here? Phi, okay, gamma, okay, LP is known to me, the gain is known to me, and instead of E, I am going to use a filtered value of E. I want to knock off high frequency from this, I want to use a filtered value of E. So my prediction is going to look something like this. Z k plus 1, okay. When I implement this forecasted input, it has not been really implemented, it is only in the model, okay. The forecast will look like this, okay. The forecast will look like this. This is LP, that notation of L, I will make it consistent, okay. Yeah. Huh. Linearized model can also? Yes. Correct, but then that signal will get captured in E. E will become biased, okay, and then that information will come up as if it's a disturbance into the signal E. Okay, so this E signal is actually trying to compensate for plant model mismatch, for unknown disturbances. So it also compensates for phi and gamma not being same as the plant. Okay, so that's a very good question. So these two compensations are essentially added to compensate for model plant mismatch, okay, that the true plant will not have phi, it could be phi prime or something, it could be gamma prime, it could be c prime, okay. So that is implicitly compensated through this signal, okay, implicitly compensated through this signal, and it helps, it's not that it doesn't work, it works with this trick works. Okay. See, what I am doing here is I am tying up this prediction with the observer. What has observer given me? Xk minus 1. If you remember here, I got xk given k minus 1, I got from the observer. I am tying this up with my prediction as the initial point, initial state. So what I am saying is that the initial state of my prediction is same as the initial state of the observer. Observer brings the information from the past to current, current to future is through this prediction, okay, and this is the meeting point, okay. Now if I implement the first move, then the predicted output will be this. What will be at k plus 2? One more instant in future, I am going to use this zk plus 1 here, you see here, okay, and then I am going to implement one more input uk plus 1 given k, okay, and I am going to assume that this disturbance remains constant over the horizon. This does not change. I made this assumption when I talked about LQ controller, same assumption I am making here, disturbance does not change over the future, okay. Estimate of the disturbance. What is this LF bringing in? It is estimate of unmeasured disturbance, it's estimate of plant model mismatch. Everything clubbed together is contained in this signal EF. LF times EF and EF here, both of them are bringing this information about unmeasured disturbances, plant model mismatch, everything is contained in this, okay. So my ZK plus 2 is going to look like phi square ZK plus 1 Z. And So here this is phi gamma uk plus 1 given k. Is this clear? Is this equation algebra clear? Here, algebra is pretty simple here, okay. What about k plus 3? I will just go on writing now difference equation. See, I have a dynamic model, I can explicitly forecast. So these z here and y here are forecasts. This is how the system will behave in future. Provided I happen to implement uk given k, uk plus 1 given k, uk plus 2 given k, I can just go on doing this till uk plus p. I can do p step ahead predictions using my difference equation model. These predictions are not open loop predictions, they are closed loop predictions. In what sense? I am feeding back information about unknown disturbances, plant model mismatch through EF. Okay, and through EF appearing here in the output. So I am correcting the output, I am correcting the state dynamics to compensate for the fact that the model may not be exact, there could be unmeasured disturbances in the state and in the output. And what is the imposter, what is used as a representative of these unknown inputs? EF, LF times EF and EF, these are used as representatives of the unknown inputs, okay. So this is my forecast, this is my forecast, okay. This is how the system will behave if I happen to implement one particular future input sequence, right. So it's like you could plot this if you are doing it very very fast, okay. You can actually, for every input you think, you can plot what's going to happen in future, right. This is the future trajectory. So I actually created one future trajectory, okay. Let us interpret this very carefully. See, what is this zk here? Zk connects with current state, okay. So this is a very 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 nice interpretation and I want you to understand this very carefully. This prediction, p step ahead predictions, okay, p step ahead predictions of what is going to happen, okay, consists of two components. One component is effect of the past on the future. This is the effect of the past on the future, and this is effect of the future on the future. A dynamic system has a memory. Okay, let's go back to this painful example of your studies. So xk given k minus 1 is the current state, okay. Will it not have effect on what's going to happen on the end sem? It will have, or your overall grades, it will have an effect, okay. But is everything lost? No, you still have project to do, you still have, you know, one end sem to write. So these are all future inputs and then you can study, okay. So these are all future inputs that will go into the system. So what will happen after some time is a cumulative effect of two things. One is past having effect on the future and future having effect on the future. Okay. So in any dynamical system, okay, there are two components that influence the future. One is past history influences the future. Okay. And the you have degrees of freedom. You can change the future. Okay. You can change the future by injecting input moves. If you make them carefully, you can change the future. Okay. You can change the future. So this is what is the message here, that there are three things here. There are three components. There is one more component here, which is effect of Pawn model mismatch and unmeasured disturbances on the future. So that is captured through this EF. Okay. So a prediction, a p step ahead prediction using this observer has three components. One is effect of the past behavior onto future, effect of future inputs on the future, and effect of past knowledge about model plan mismatch and disturbances onto the future. Okay. So these three things which So in some sense this model also reflects what in here we keep saying, what's going to happen in future is your purane karmon ka. So all this old karma comes through, you know, x hat k given k minus 1. But everything is not lost. You have a degree of freedom to change the future. So that is given. So these two things here, this and this, will bring in the effect of the past, and this is the future which you can manipulate. So P here is called as prediction horizon. Okay. Okay. Now, how do I want to move from the current point to the final point? See, I am not at the set point. Currently, I am not at the set point. Okay. Let's say you are driving or you are piloting a plane and you want to go from, say, height 10,000 meters to 15,000 meters. Okay. What should be your set point trajectory? Should it be, you know, within one instant 15,000, or it should go gradually? Depends. Depends if you are, civilian pilot or whether you are a, you know, a fighter pilot. If you are a fighter pilot, you want to go from 10,000 to 15,000 in the next second. That's because maybe some missile is behind you and then you want to move as fast as possible to the new set point. And you don't mind if it overshoots, and you know, but of course if you are a civilian pilot, you want to go gradually to the new set point. Okay. How do you achieve this? Okay. Let me, before I do the maths, let me show this visually. What happened? Ah, here. I think my figure has got moved. So the question is, when I'm moving from here to here, and I'm moving from here to here, this is my final set point. This is my 15,000 feet. I am currently at 10,000 feet. Okay? You have been cruising near the 10,000 feet and suddenly you want to go to 15,000 feet. I'm just giving here in terms of percentages. Okay, you want to go to the this particular. So should my trajectory be like a step, future trajectory, or should it be gradual? Okay, should I move very very slowly here? Should I move by this trajectory? Should I move by this trajectory? You know, I have an option. I can create a future trajectory to move from current point to the final point. Okay, and then what I can say is that a prediction should be as close as possible to this trajectory. Is that okay? See, I am predicting. Okay. How do you choose the moves? You choose the moves such that, you know, the predicted behavior is very close to this desired behavior. Okay. So I am giving a desired behavior from the current operating point to the final operating point. Okay. So this is done through this trajectory generation. I think this figure should have been figure has moved to a wrong point. Okay. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to do this one slide is just to show that this particular model is equivalent to something. Okay. Let's come here. So how do I choose the inputs? When you give me these inputs, you should not give me an arbitrary input. You should not say that, input can go from 0 to some infinity. You cannot do that. You can change the input only at certain rates. You can change the input only within certain bounds. So when I'm selecting these inputs, they should be chosen properly by the optimizer. Optimizer should know the limits on the inputs. For optimizer, that can be done by specifying the constraints. Okay, so I can actually give the constraints. I can also say that, after all, I am not going to implement all the future input moves. Okay, I am not going to implement all the future input moves. I am going to implement only one of them. I am going to discard the future input moves. Okay, and then, I am going to redo the optimization problem again. Okay, then why compute next? Suppose I am predicting over next 2 hours. Why compute a future trajectory over next 2 hours if I am going to use only first 1 minute part of it? Okay, so what we do is what is called as input blocking. So instead of using, I'll just show you the equations look complex. I'll show you picture that will show. Instead of saying that I am going to manipulate over the entire future horizon, I am going to say that I am going to manipulate over one input in the next, then say I am going to keep the input constant over next 3 instants, I am going to keep input constant over next 5 instants, I am going to keep input constant over next, over the prediction. Okay, instead of changing every input in the future, I am going to constrain the movement in the future. That is because even if I compute all these inputs optimally, I am not going to use them again. Okay, I'm just going to throw it, use only one move and move ahead. Okay, so what I typically do is I don't use entire degrees of freedom into the future. I constrain it. Second thing is I should choose this future input moves in such a way that they are within the bounds. Right, this u low is the lower bound. Okay, u high is the higher bound, upper bound. I should choose them in such a way that difference between 2 successive moves is also constrained. I cannot excessively increase between two sampling instants. I cannot excessively decrease between 2 sampling instants. These are the real problems. If you have a control ball, you cannot take it from 50% to 0% in one second. Okay, you can probably take it from 50% to 49%. Otherwise, the mechanism will break. So, there is a limit on which you can actually move a system. So those limits will get told to the optimizer. So the limits on the move at a time, okay, these are called as rate of change of moves. Okay, and then there is a constraint on, look here, I have drawn this constraint boundary. This is the upper limit, this is the lower limit. You cannot choose inputs beyond this point. There is a limit on how much I can move at a time. Okay, so I should actually obey all these input constraints when I forecast. Okay, so that is implicit in optimization problem. And of course, I talked about this future set point trajectory. Future set point trajectory generated by filtering technique. Okay, you actually filter the current set point minus the current output through a difference equation. A linear difference equation will actually create a filtered signal into the future. Okay, again, just go back and think about what we have been doing till now. This equation looks a little complex. Yeah, input blocking. See, I can formulate the problem over the future by taking degrees of freedom. Can I go ahead and then come back again to input blocking? I'll do that. It will become more clear why I'm saying that. Okay. So there is mathematical way of generating future set point trajectories, and that is given here. Let's assume that there is a way of generating the future set point trajectories, and then how fast or how slowly you take it from the current point to the next point can be decided by a tuning parameter gamma. So that parameter gamma I have given here. This is nothing but linear difference equation again. This is again a linear difference equation. I am generating set point trajectories from one point to the other point. This is a tuning parameter. I choose it once. Okay. So every time I am at a current point, I will generate a smooth trajectory from here to. Okay. Okay. Now what I am going to do is, let's skip this target business. Okay. So what I am going to do now is I am going to form MPC problem as a constraint optimization problem. Constraint optimization problem, which is such that this is the future set point trajectory minus the future prediction. The difference between the future set point trajectory and the future prediction, that is given by this E. Okay. What is this ES? ES is the final value where you want to reach. Okay. ES is the final value where you want to reach. Okay. So for the time being, forget about this ES. You understand what is this YR? This is the future set point trajectory which I have generated. I generated this set point trajectory here. Right? I am currently at this point. I want to move here. Okay. And let's say this is my future set point trajectory. This green value is what I want to use. This is my future set point trajectory. I want to move along this trajectory. Okay. Now, what I am doing here, I am defining the error between the desired trajectory and the forecast. On the forecast. Okay. What is it that I can change in the future? Future input moves. Okay. So these are my future input moves. Okay. This part, y hat k plus j given k, what does it depend upon? Future input moves. It depends upon the future input moves. Okay. So the difference between the future set point and the future behavior will be governed by future input moves. Okay. I have defined here E transpose WE. I am defining some kind of a distance measure. What is this square of the distance? This E transpose W. See, this is error vector, error between set point and the prediction. Okay. That transpose WE will give you square of the distance. Okay. Then I am penalizing the input moves. Okay. I am putting some weight on the future inputs. Okay. And what is my MPC formulation? My formulation is minimize this objective function with respect to the future inputs. Okay. Minimize this objective function. What is this objective function? Sum of the square of errors from what is this error between future behavior and a desired future set point. I have a desired future set point, I have a desired predicted behavior, I have predicted behavior in the future. The difference between that should be as small as possible. Ideally, what should happen? It should actually follow that future set point trajectory. Okay. But I want to do this, I want to minimize this difference such that, you know, you don't take excessive input moves. I don't change the input suddenly. Okay. I am putting a weighting here factor on input moves. Okay. I am putting a weighting factor here on input moves. And just 1 minute, let me complete this. So this optimization problem is subject to constraints. What are the constraints? One constraint is the prediction constraint. This model is being used to predict y hat k. Okay, prediction constraint. Subject to bounds on the inputs. Okay, and subject to bounds on the moon subject to bounds on the predicted outputs. The predicted output should not go, you know, predicted output should not go much beyond the some constraints. Okay, so this optimization problem, input blocking constraints. So all these constraints are solved. So this problem in which you minimize this objective function subject to model equations, prediction equations, subject to constraints on the inputs, on input moves, on predicted future outputs, okay, this problem is solved online. Okay, this problem is solved online. Okay, so is this idea clear? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to solve this online optimization problem. Okay, and what I'm okay that after I get the optimal input moves, I'm going to just use this. I'm just going to set the optimal move, only first move in that optimal input profile I'm going to implement. Okay, only the first move in that optimal input profile I'm going to implement. I'm going to reject the entire optimal, reformulate the optimization problem at the next point, okay, and resolve it. Okay, why do I need to do this? Because the disturbances keep changing all the time. Okay, where is the information about disturbances coming in? Through this L times epsilon. Okay, so through this L times here, this EF will bring in the information about the disturbances, plant model mismatch, that can change every instant. So I can't trust my optimal solution too much. I just implement one move. Okay, I just implement one move and then resolve the problem for k plus 1 to k plus p plus 1. Okay, so I keep solving sequence of optimization problems. There is no one closed form solution. There is no one closed form solution. Okay. Well, this blocking is little difficult to understand in the beginning. What I'll do is I'll slightly modify my notes and upload them. I want you to implement this controller on your system. Okay. So that is the real test of whether you understood what I'm trying to teach in this course or not. Okay. So if you can make it work, nothing like it. Okay. So now why I'm blocking? I'm blocking, okay, because you know, anyway, even if I were to consider all future input moves and not block them, see, if I were not to block the if I were to optimize entire future input moves, I'm just going to use one of them, right? I'm going to discard rest. So to reduce the dimension of the optimization problem, okay, I put this constraint. So the moment I put this constraint, the dimension of the optimization problem is reduced, and then you work in a lower dimensional space than the higher dimensional space. Yeah. So this input constraints, if you put this input constraints, you will get a kind of suboptimal solution compared to if you don't do this. That is there. But then you know I am not trusting my suboptimal solution too much, right? I'm just taking one move and then I'm discarding the rest. So we try to do this because we want to reduce the dimension of optimization problem. Okay. So we'll come back to this again. To do after all that,